So we'll have a quick recap of what we did in the previous class. So we have been doing a lot of work on the So these were some of the elements which we saw that had been designed. Okay, so we've got walls and slabs. So the various kinds, solid, it might be the hollow core, it might be a little, it might be one which is cast in the site and have a topping put, okay, called the filigree slab. Or we may even have sandwich panels. The walls may be load bearing or non-load bearing. And these are some of the decorative elements which we have. Right. So these were some of the types of precast panels which we also saw. Okay. So, and these are the elements which we normally design. We gave a very long list, okay, for each of the types. Like it could be composite floors, or we could have longitudinal joints between floor elements, various types of column to column connection, beam to column connection, so on and so forth. Okay. So today we'll be going through some of the joints. We'll be looking at the way the joints are made. Okay, we are going to see how the joints are made. Okay, so if you look at this, this is one of the sections which we have in GDN block. As you go down the steps, you should be able to see this. You'll be able to see this cut lintel. This is something which you this is just to show you, like, you know, where all we are actually having it. So the along with the cut lintel, you can also have the sunshade. Now we are coming to today's lecture. We are going to look at the joints in precast construction, and you may find that this precast, many of you have not submitted your topic, you'll find that for your J component, this would be one of the ideal case to take and study, because this is something which is the only thing which is unique in a prefab construction. You may have lot of other things like elements. You can change the shape of elements. Probably you can try to bring out a new element itself, or a new type of connection, better than what I'm going to present today. Okay, you could model that in SolidWorks or some software, maybe Revit, architecture, whatever you're comfortable with. Show a 3D view of how these match and why is it better than what is available. Okay, based on some research which you are doing. So these are some of the things which you could probably be doing in this course, or maybe this would be the only important thing which you can do in this course. Okay, now I'm going to just show you this. This is the first kind of connection which we have. This is a simple base. If you look at it, this is so much similar to the base, the column base which is there in the steel structures. You will have a base plate which rests on screws, which is aligned by using screws, and then you will be having the whole thing done. Okay, in case I don't remember putting it, but for my next, that is for my steel structures class, I collected some photographs of this base. Maybe I should have put it here also, but don't worry. How many of you know the VIT flag post? Should have seen it. Okay, it's very difficult to miss. Go to the base of the column. Okay, you'll find that there's a gap. The whole thing rests on bolts, and on top also you got a bolt. So what happens is you can align the entire flagpole using those bolts. And this is something which is happening here also. You got a base plate which is connected to the column. This comes to the pedestal which is done before, and you align it, make it sit. You make it sit tight, and then you apply grout. Okay. Typically, this space which is there. Oh my goodness. That's my mouse. Okay, right. It's here. Okay. So when you see this gap will be equal to the projection which is there beyond the face of the column to the face of the pedestal. So if it is 25 mm all around, the gap between the pedestal and the base plate will be 25 mm, so that you get a 45 degree splay, and there's a load distribution and all the other stuff. Okay, 25 mm is one of the standards, but again the grout thickness depends on the load which is appearing, which is coming. Okay, this is a general point which I'd like to share with you, because when you go and design the
elements, you designed the structural elements for probably like we used to design elements for the machines. It might be a crusher, it might be a pulley which is coming. So depending on the load, you may have to give a different grout thickness. But typically it's around 25 mm, 50 mm and so on and so forth. Okay. And grout is a very costly item. So you try to reduce the thickness of grout, because beyond a particular limit, it doesn't play any role. This is a general point which I'd like to just share with you. And you see, you can see that the column has four vertical rods protruding out. Okay, you'll be seeing in some of the in the next slide how this kind of a this connection can be done. So you just have a look at this. The column from above has pockets or recesses made. Okay, and that comes and sits exactly where the this one is kept. And see, there is a plate. The plate goes beyond. So you screw the you bolt in the plate, and the column above also gets connected. And this area is grouted again. The space is again grouted. Guys, if you got something to share, you got a doubt, please stand up and ask. The whole class will benefit. Okay. Otherwise, you can just use any communication method. Yeah. Thank you. Why do they? Why they don't? Male female. It's something like a male female connection. But see, if I'm going to put a male female connection over here, you don't have the ability to bolt. Okay. The ability to bolting is removed. Now actually what happens, all the reinforcement rod could be tied rigidly to the plate here, or they give a shear connector, shear stud welder, which is welded to the which will be welded to the points over here. So the reinforcing rod which is coming, can you see there's a second rod which is seen? Bolts in concrete directly can be used under certain circumstances. Okay, like for example, you can drill a hole, put an anchor bolt and then connect it. But then if you are able to work out a solution which you can directly do instead of using the steel plate, then what you are saying can be done. But from practical considerations, these have been put into place. Okay. So typically what happens is these are called shear connectors. These are called shear connectors. So they will be having sufficient development length. Okay. And then this is connected to the plate, and the plate is connected to the column below with bolts. And these bolts will also be anchored to a suitable length. So you can see the anchorage here. Okay. So the main rod comes, it's bent and taken away. And this is the development length which it has to have. So all that is based on your simple IS 456 standard only. Okay. So when you're wanting an alternate solution, it should still satisfy the other codal provisions, okay, like IS 456. That is going to be the governing criteria for your concrete design still, okay. So I hope I have clarified the doubt. It's more from practical considerations that we don't use any other system, okay. But I think you are saying that, you know, there's that male-female connection, which I think I will show in the next one, which is a sleeved connection. Yeah, correct. That is a sleeved connection. Usually, that maybe the terminology which you and I are using is different. But now I remember that there is that connection also, where it's a sleeve. But anyway, it would amount to a male and female connection. Okay. Now just go through this video, please. This video will give you an idea as to how this connection is being made. Okay. The shear connections at the bottom, okay. Shear studs were there at the bottom, okay.
That's for developing more friction. Concrete is being poured. See, that plate which went is called a template, okay, so that the bolts are kept in position. These will normally be torque control wrenches. You cannot just tighten it as you like.
This is a grouting process. What is coming is now grout. Okay. So, like this, there are a lot of videos. In fact, in your course page, Moodle course page, I have uploaded one link. So you just go, it's about a 10 minute video, so I don't want to spend my time here. So those of you interested, please go through that. And typically you'll find that this is from one of the actual construction sites which we did. So here if you see, this pocket which is kept is a very standard construction practice. This is for a steel column which is going to subsequently come. And what you see in the middle is the shear pocket. Okay, so if you remember the shear key which you studied in your steel design, this is the place where it goes into. And typically we call this the bathtub approach because we dig the entire place up and do the construction. Okay, so I just want to tell you that, you know, this is very easy to do at site, and this is something which is very commonly done. In a steel structure, you just will be putting it in. Again, there will be grouting done. Okay, the gap between the base plate and the pedestal top will still be grouted. Okay. Now, this is your connection. I hope this is the one you were wanting to talk about. The sleeve connection. Okay. So here what happens is, a sleeve is preformed. Putting a sleeve is very easy. You just have to put a filler material and concrete and remove the filler. Then you get this pocket. So now what happens is, the rods which are kept are sent in, and there will be grout holes already done. Okay, so these four holes which you see are holes for grouting. Grouting is done from the bottom to the top. Why is it done from the bottom to the top? It is done like that so that air is, entrapped air will be forced out of the pocket. Okay, we don't want any holes in that. So you keep grouting, and the grout will just flow out. When you see that there are no bubbles, you will stop grouting. That is, you'll be grouting till the till you're sure that there's no air hole. So then what happens? You can just plug both the holes, grout will set, and you'll find that it's a solid connection. Okay. So again, this length is dependent on the development length. This is going to depend on the development length which you have. So you can see in this place, where you are having the pocket, you are having the rod come in, and then after grouting, this is how it looks like. Okay, so this is your answer, I hope. Okay, now all these figures are taken from a book, Fundamentals of Building Constructions by E. Allen. Okay, so there is one or two copies of the book. This is the textbook for the first year BTech students for building construction, so construction materials rather. So you can just outsmart your juniors and get a book probably. Okay, the number of copies are very few, so please take it up. The title is put at the bottom in case you are interested to take it down now. Now look at this. We saw till now connection between a column to column, or column base to or pedestal to column. Now here we are going to see a beam column connection. You got a corbel. Now what we do is, here again we'll have some rods which are given for continuity. So after we put it, after we place it, we'll simply fill up the pockets. Okay, we'll simply fill up the pockets. Typically what happens is, the post tensioning cable will be used for this connection. Okay, so then what happens, the beam and column are being post tension from both the sides, forcing the beam and column to behave like one. Okay, so this is the post tension beam column connection. Okay, and usually you'll always keep a bearing pad below the below the beam. For instance, if you see the railway track, we've got a neoprene pad. The neoprene pad absorbs all the impact which is being given by the locomotive. So you can imagine the amount of the impact which is being put on the sleeper, but all of that is just being taken up by a very thin neoprene pad. Okay, so also we can use so many other materials also to reduce the impact of the
load from the beam to the corbel or columns. Okay.
Yes. Yes. So the question is, just tell me if I understood your question right. When we are post tensioning, do we have the beam, the tendon running from end to end? That is through the, from the through the beam and the column to the other side. Yes, it is being done so. Okay, it is actually being Sometimes you may find that the tendon from this side may terminate here, and you could use the jack and tension also. Alternatively, it could be running through from end to end, and you got this pocket so that you can grout the opening. Yes, it will definitely exert a pressure on the column, and the column will be designed for such a force. Typically, you may also increase the shear reinforcement in this zone. Okay, because there is a criteria called the bursting stress. Okay, so things like that are also normally, they are all well known to people. So all those will be taken into account when these joints are designed. In fact, my dear friends, when you are designing a joint, you need to think a little deeper, like what was just asked. What would happen? Wouldn't it crush and fail? So what are we going to do to prevent it? You have to think as if you are sitting in that place and experiencing that force. If you are going to be able to do that, definitely you are going to be very successful in any design which you undertake. Okay. So I'm just moving on. So here what you see is, you've got a single or a few reinforcing rods or vertical rods, not exactly reinforcing rods, these are just dowels. So we will, again this is like a male-female connection where the beam comes and rests on the column. Again you've got a bearing pad, okay, and once you also have some shear reinforcements which are put around. Okay, now what happens when this comes and sits, the continuity is got, this, and you grout it, the continuity is got between this vertical rod and the beam because of the presence of these links. Okay, so this will cause the member to behave like one. Then you will have a grouting arrangement. So you may grout from the side probably, and then grout till the till all the air is removed, and then you've got the integral connection, and you've got an integral connection. So this is another way by which you can have the jointing done. Okay. Now moving on, look at this one. You will have insert plates in the column. So when you're doing the concreting, when you're doing the shuttering properly, you will keep these insert plates in position. These are not just plates, they'll also have shear studs at the back. These shear studs ensure that the plate cannot be pulled out by the design forces. Okay, the design forces will not cause the plate to come out. Okay. So what happens is, on this beam, you will have a plate on the face. There is a beam on the face of the beam. Okay, there is another slide, you know, in one of the subsequent connections, you will be able to see the plate also, this cross-section of the plate. So what happens now, because these are there, okay, you can probably even weld the two plates. So welding the two plates causes an integral connection to be made. Okay, again, this is not something new. You have so many of the welded connections for steel structures. Instead of welding two steel members, you are keeping a plate which enables you to weld two concrete sections. That's all. Okay. So again, you can have pre-stressing tendons, and whatever you see on top, these other shear links for subsequent connection with the element on top. It might be usually a slab. Now you see the hollow core slabs are kept. These are just, you know, these are small planks which are brought in. Then you may have some reinforcing rods to tie the two slabs so that they start to behave like one. See, whenever you are having a reinforcement across a section, then only you are going to have continuity. See, if you are going to keep a reinforcing if you're going to design a beam column junction, what do? You take the rod, and then what is the length to which you take the rod into the column from the beam? To a distance of LD, which typically is 50 times diameter of the bar, but because you've got a 90 degree bend, you can reduce a 10D, which means 40D you are going to take the rod into the column, and that is measured from the face of the column. Okay, so that principle is applied here also. And again, if a beam is supposed to act continuous over a support, a reinforcement rod should be taken across the section. So that's what's happening here. Now what happens, you've got you can put some more reinforcing rods here, and you will be filling up this gap, you'll be grouting this gap, and then what results will have the same strength as a continuous slab. This will be a filigree slab or a that's a topping which you provide. So here, if you see, we can have the welded angle, the insert plate, and then the angle. So this is one type of connection. Now we'll go on to another type. This is a double T section. Again, see, you're keeping rods which will ensure that there is longitudinal continuity between the two double T's which you have. Okay. And if you want, you can put a topping on top. And see, at the bottom, this is also sitting on a double T. So that T can just sit here, you connect it, you are having a continuous joints, and the structure is going to be performing to what you require it to perform. Okay. Now this is the steel plate which I wanted to tell you. So suppose the section of the beam is taken, you will have a steel plate on the face of the beam, and the other things like your shear links etc. is provided. And if you look at this, the mesh which is provided, this is across the in the opening only, okay, the place where the two T's are sitting. Okay, so you will be able to get continuity between the sections. You get a continuity between the sections. Now if suppose you look at the European guidelines per se, these are the 5 or 6 points which you have to take into account. So whenever you are going to go in for a design, you will be ensuring that, when you are saying mechanical resistance and stability, is nothing but the strength of the section. Okay. So the other things I think is quite clear. So these are the parameters which you probably might be seeing in addition to the normal design of the section. Normal design of the section. Okay. So today we've seen these points. We've seen the connection between columns to bases, column to column, and beam to column, probably also slab to beam. And these are my references. Okay, Allen, Fundamentals of Building Constructions, Materials and Methods, 6th edition. And one video which you saw is based on, this is the link to that video. Okay. So I'll end my slide with a thank you. This lecture on connections between various precast elements is concluding with this. Okay. So do you have any doubts in what we saw now? Would you like me to revisit any of the slides? This one. Yes, what about this? Okay, what would you like me to explain, please? Okay, where it is useful, wherever you feel a structure is required, which can be done with a precast system rather than a cast in situ system, you can use this. Now, this double T is a system where you got the flange acts like the floor. You don't have to bring in a separate hollow core system, place it, you will be having the T, there are two T's, double T passed earlier and brought in, kept it. If you are asking for specific application, typically this is used in parking structures. Okay, this is very popular for car parking structures. Okay, so I hope that clarifies. Now answer the last. What's your doubt, please? Let the whole class benefit. No problem. Please ask.
Wait. Shear legs are. Can you see one U, inverted U? Okay. Usually you can see in this slide. If you are not able to make out, you are welcome to come a little closer. Okay. So this area you can see an inverted U, which is coming above the like here. Can you see this? Okay. So that is the shear leg. Now these rods which you see are given so that you can get continuity between the various elements. For example, this is one double T. What you see here is one double T. Like that, there will be a sequence of double T's. Now what happens is, suppose you are not giving this longitudinal tie, each of the double T will act individually. Now you don't want that to happen. You want to tie it in such a manner that they'll be able to share the load when it's loaded, so that they behave integrally. So you give reinforcement in every direction where you want continuity. You want longitudinal continuity, so you provide it in this direction, longitudinal to the double T. In the transverse direction also you want continuity, so you provide these bars. Okay. Any other doubts, please? Okay. So I'll end my lecture here.